Hey, welcome to Tales from the Troll Hole. I'm your host, Cecil B., and together we're going to dive deep into the internet and find what stories there are to be read, enjoyed, laughed at, cried with, you name it. Thanks for coming along on this journey with me. Now grab your torch and pitchfork.
Let's dive into this troll hole.
Welcome to this week's episode of Tales from the Troll Hole. I am so excited for you to listen to this episode because it's my very first guest episode. I have a really special person on this week's episode, and she is super smart, super funny, super talented, and specifically, she has her master's in psychology, and she is a professor at Chapman University for Human Sexuality. She has her own podcast. And the highest accolade of all, she is my big sister. It is Ashley Weller joining me in this episode where we talk about really bad cooking, among other things. But I'm excited and thanks for joining us. And please enjoy this episode of Tales from the Troll Hole. It is now November 1st, which means that it is officially Christmas. Am I correct? And we're taking...
No.
I know, but you have to just say yes. So it's Christmas,
I
right?
I believe in Thanksgiving. I believe
I'm
in
getting
Thanksgiving.
There. I'm getting there. Agree with me and then we'll get there.
Okay, you're right. It is Christmas. La 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 la.
Thank you. And we take a brief intermission from Christmas towards the end of November for Thanksgiving. And then it's Christmas again until January 2nd. That's how we do this. And I think the highlight of these 2 months of Christmas is definitely, I mean, you've heard that song, the 60 days of Christmas, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. On the 37th day of Christmas, my true love gave to me
27 mismatched socks.
Oh, nice. 37 cocktail umbrellas.
The highlight of the 60 days of Christmas, it's cooking. That's what it is.
Yeah. No, facts.
This is food month, whether you celebrate Thanksgiving or Indigenous Peoples Day or just Mashed Potatoes Day, whatever you are celebrating, you will be eating. This is really great. I think some of my go-to things for this time of year are I make a really good vegetable pot pie. I make the crust homemade and everything. You will be eating it, actually.
Oh, fantastic. I'll be making you a really delicious wild rice stuffed acorn squash.
Yes. You've made that for me before, and it gets better every time.
Yeah, because I get better every time.
Yes. That's how I feel about this pot pie. Like, I make the crust from scratch, and okay, you're going to have to literally take this with a grain of salt. It is a gluten-free vegan pot pie. So take your bar and lower it, and then I'm going to pole vault over it.
But is your wiener going to hit the pole? And
of course it is. And I was thinking it, and I'm so glad you said it. My acorn squash will be jostled.
It's good.
So I like that.
No, you're right, though. The food this time of year, just it's like, I want to make this food year round, but you fucking can't. You can't make stuffing and pot pie and chili in 90 degree weather. Like, you can't do that.
No. And I feel like I get a little bit more of a pass to do that up here in Washington than you do in Southern California.
Fair.
Because if I was visiting you and you offered me chili, I'd throw up.
It's a chilled chili. It's like gazpacho chili.
Put it in an ice cube tray, crack off a few, and I'll suck on it. Like a lozenge.
Chili lozenge, if you will.
Oh, I will.
I'm going to pour you a glass of vegetable stock and put chili ice cubes in it.
A fine vintage. Is that a noodle? You choke on it and just pull out a whole noodle out of your throat. Oh, let's do a hot take real quick. Hot take.
Oh my God.
Mashed potatoes You leave the skins on, right?
Oh, it depends on the tater, precious.
Okay. Well, okay, I do it for all of them.
For russet potatoes, I don't, because I feel like the russet potato is dirty and has hair and like little like sprouty spuds. I usually leave them on for a fingerling. Totally leave them on, because who's peeling a fucking finger? You're going to peel your finger is what you're going to do. But for the rose potatoes, the little red ones, totally leaving the skins on. There's lots of antioxidants in those bad boys. For the Yukon Gold, those skins are like velvet. They're like added butter. Like you have to leave them on. But for a russet, get the fuck out of here with your skin. Get out of here. You got to go.
That's really funny, because I only do russet potatoes because I can't be bothered to learn about the other varieties. And also, I leave them on all the time. And if I make a baked potato, I eat all of the potato.
Okay. No man left behind. Got it. Okay. Yeah. I mean, you're seasoning it. So yeah, I mean, you season the outside with salt and oil, right?
I do not. Here's the thing though. Oh, you might not like this actually. After I eat the baked potato, I take the hollow shell and I crumple it up into a ball and dip it in ketchup.
Oh my God. We need to end this. Like this podcast.
I lost you.
I'm gone. Okay. What is wrong with you? Actually, that does kind of make sense if you think about it, because potatoes, ketchup, french fries.
That's what I'm saying. It's good. And also, I hate wasting any part of a potato because they're the gemstone of the dirt.
I implore you, I beg of you, please, the next time you make a baked potato, all I'm asking you to do is get some oil, massage the tater, and then just sprinkle a little bit of the good salt, you know, like the Himalayan pink cracky, just a little bit on the outside. And then when you take the tater out, it's the skin is like crunchy, crispy, yummy. And then dip it in the ketchup and tell me that your mind and your life have not been changed.
All right. Unfortunately, I think I'm going to lose you here again. Because when I say I make a baked potato, I mean, I put it in the microwave for 10 minutes.
You can still do the oil and salt and redeem yourself.
Yeah. Perfect segue, however, because we're talking about bad recipes today. I have been just looking at articles and online forums that talk about how strange recipes were mid-century till possibly even present day, perchance. Perhaps. I'm sure that there's going to be recipes that are okay. Also, semi-homemade with Sandra Lee.
Oh.
Some of those.
Love her.
Yes, but also some of those are going in the books for sure with these strange recipes.
One shot.
Oh, 10 seconds later, she must have worked at the Horseshoe here in Bellingham, because that is the heaviest hand I've ever seen. Okay.
This is my hero.
To get things started, I think we should talk about the worst thing that we have ever personally made, thinking that it was going to be good.
Oh, I know exactly what I made that was terrible. It was for you.
It was the acorn squash. I knew it.
No, it was macaroni and cheese.
Oh, I'll never forget that. That was foul.
I hope not. It was
please.
Horrifying.
Set the scene.
To the listener, I was 10 years old. So imagine yourself at 10, helpless. But I was babysitting three children and making mac and cheese. And I forgot to drain the water. And so I boiled the noodles, I added the cheese, I added the butter, I added the milk, I measured it all out. And I was like, this is really like soupy. So I made you white bread and soupy mac and cheese, and everyone revolted. And like, also I used to make scrambled eggs in the microwave because I wasn't allowed to use the stove.
Yep.
That's probably the worst thing that I've ever made.
I'll agree with that, because
survey says
that was pretty bad. And I remember we didn't want to hurt your feelings, but we were laughing and we were like, this is so bad. What did you do? We watched, I remember because we were all pretty close in age.
I put hot dogs in it too.
Yeah. So it was like a weird milky hot dog soup with butter.
With noodles in.
Yeah. And this is a Kraft mac and cheese from the box. This is, yeah. That's what that, it wasn't even the fun shapes either.
It wasn't even redeemed. No.
No.
I didn't know about roux at the time. So I couldn't like add flour and like sicken the bitch.
Yeah. No. We would have been like, roux? What character of Winnie the Pooh is that?
Oh, God.
But
what did you make that was terrible?
Similar boat here. I was cooking for the siblings. This was after you had moved out. It was my turn to wonder what the fuck had just happened. There was we all had a pretty decent appetite growing kids. What are we going to do? So I look in the cupboard and I wanted to make something that they were going to like be excited about. And I was like, SpaghettiOs, dope. This is perfect. But that's not going to be enough because we only have one can. Because normally I would make like two cans for all of us.
Yeah. And toast with butter on it.
Naturally, as you do.
Right. As one does.
Well, now I want buttered toast. God, I just ate 20 metric tons of pad thai and I want buttered toast right now. So we have the single can of SpaghettiOs. And then I look and I'm like, what else can I do? A can of Chef Boyardee ravioli.
I'm like, I'll mix them.
Mix them, right? Apparently not. Something chemical happened in that cooking pot that I, to this day, will not understand. But I failed to make dinner, but instead made something that would have cooled into a tire for an 18-wheeler. It smelled like burning rubber. It was so bad. Nothing was burning on the stove.
Oh, my God.
It didn't even burn in the pot. I stirred it. I was stirring it. And they were sitting at the table because you know how we would all just hang out in that kitchen?
In the kitchen. So everyone's watching you cook like it's fucking Top Chef. And you're like, here's your Kraft soup and hot dogs.
No, this is bottom chef. This is terrible. So I was trying and they were laughing. And then in that moment, the flashback happened.
Shame.
I will. Absolutely. If someone's kink is cooking terrible food, I will judge them. Like, oh, that's another tangent here. So, you know, the terrible cooking videos where they're making really weird ass shit.
Yeah.
Apparently that's a kink video.
There is a kink where people put body parts in food called splooshing.
That's foul. I hate this.
No, actually, it's really pretty sometimes because they put like parts like of their butt, like their butts in sprinkles, and then their butt is covered in sprinkles. It's really pretty. It's like art.
I'm gonna trust your judgment on that because
made Bacrid SpaghettiO beef ravioli. I wonder if it was the variation of tomato sauce or if one of the cans had developed botulism.
There was a clear and present danger of both of those possibilities, I think. But ultimately, what happened was I tried to eat it because I was in denial about what had happened. But I did have a flash of karma where I was like, I shouldn't have laughed at Ashley about the macaroni. I did have that happen. So that's so funny that you told that story.
Thank you.
I ate it and I got so sick. I was like, no, this is fine. This is fine. I'm going to eat this and you're the crazy.
Everyone's eating it.
You're the crazy ones. And so they just made cereal because that was always an option.
And toast.
Yes. Also, hear me out. Another tangent. What about savory cereal? Is that a thing? Like you put goldfish crackers in a bowl, eat it with milk. Is that insane?
Okay. So I'm going to say maybe, but does it have to be milk? What if you did noodles and broth and called it ramen?
That could never work. With the body parts and food thing, that reminds me of one time. You remember when the internet was crazy and there were no warnings about anything? And you could disguise links in AOL Instant Messenger.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think I was sent by someone a video that was disguised as like Lord of the Rings, blah, 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 because they know that I'm a big dork and they were trying to prank me. So I click on it and then it's ladies sitting on a cake. And then she turns to the camera and she says, you know what I love? Cake farts. And then she rips ass into the cake and I'll never forget it. It was terrible. Of course I sent it to everybody I knew.
course.
Of course.
Cake first.
Yeah. So anyway.
Speaking of cake, I think that it is important to recognize that I think one of the reasons that food got so horrible, and by the way, it was really just horrible here, like in this country.
Oh, yes, like, I'm sure.
It was terrible. And it was like the 70s and the 80s. And I think part of the problem is that we as Americans don't have culture. Mm-mm. And like when you go to France, they've got the sauce, they got the boulelé, and they've got the Bordeaux, and they've got the Vachemont. Oh, they say la vie, and of course, we're going the sauce and the crab, and I'll see you just for that. Oh. And so they, and like you go to Italy, and of course, they have fucking mangia mangia pasta, and you go to Germany, and even Germany has fucking food. You can get schnitzel. We think that we lack culture. And so in the 70s and the 80s, they were like, what can we do? I know, let's put fruit and meat in jello. What now, bitch? Like, let's fucking go. I know. Let's make corned beef hash. What?
I think part of it had to be, too, that I think everyone was microdosing LSD.
Facts. No, absolutely. Everyone. Facts. Oh, and also, microwaves were like such a fad. And it was like, what can I cook in this fucking? It was like easy bake ovens for adults.
I just had that thought the other day because it's a light bulb. It's the same shit. Exactly the same.
Yeah. It's funny. Actually, did you ever do the culture fair in like junior high?
Those words together sound familiar and give me anxiety. So probably.
Okay. Super traumatizing. So remember the culture fair at Sacagawea? Shout out WARRILRS. Worries. Remember in like ninth grade, we got told you're going to do a culture fair where you have to put together a poster board of your culture and bring a dish that represents your culture and talk about like your family heritage and stuff. And I didn't know what to put on my board. I don't remember what went on my board, but I do remember that I made peach cobbler with Bisquick and canned peaches and like just topped it with some cinnamon. And mom was like, that's our dish. That's our cultural dish is peach cobbler. Peach cobbler is what our family is known for. And I'm like, our family is known for the recipe on the back of the, what are we, Toll House? Nestle Toll House? Like, what's the Bisquick? Like, we're the Bisquick family. The recipe is on the back of a box of biscuits. Like, this isn't culture. This is like horrible food 101.
Yeah, what? I don't think that was peach cobbler as much as peige clobber.
Yeah, no. And the whole tuna casserole hamburger helper era of like life.
Okay, I will say tuna helper slaps the fuck though.
You're insane.
Yes, I am.
We're going to go back to the potato skin in ketchup.
Oh, also check this out. I used to take those big giant loaves of bread that you would get at Albertsons by the checkout. They'd have them for what, like $1.79? Mm-hmm. I would take the whole ass thing of bread, hollow out, make it like a tube, like a big.
No, I'm aware. Tube. When I would go to slice it for spaghetti night, it would just be bread skin.
That was also Lindsay, though. If I was going to hollow it out, I was going to do this. It was. Because if I was going to hollow it out, here's what I would do. I would also make a box of Zatarain's. Which is, if you are not cultured, it is seasoned rice in a box.
Literally the fanciest I've ever felt.
So I would make that and then I would put it in the bread. I would stuff this loaf.
That's like a gumbo bread bowl now. But that's then, fancy as fuck.
But then, like, I know people can't see what I'm doing, but it's like I'm holding a saxophone, but instead of a saxophone, it's bread filled with rice and salt. And that's what I would eat.
Oh, I love that. So it was like a sandwich.
But not at all. And sometimes, you know, when you really fuck your body up with a bunch of garbage food and then you're like, I need a lettuce now. I would. That's exactly what would happen. So I feel like I know how to make good food. I know that. But also there is a ravenous raccoon that lives deep in but mine is getting higher up the spine. It just keeps climbing.
The dopamine is released immediately. I think that some of the worst recipes probably came. Oh, you know what I think I might have? Hold on.
Okay.
Oh, God. Oh, you guys. Okay. I have.
I remember that book. I remember that book.
This cookbook. All-time favorite recipes.
Whose favorite? Whomst.
Whose favorite? This is from 1976. Mm. Rice stuffed steaks. I just opened that. Just random. Let's see. Beefy onion pie. Beefy hash onion. Hash. There's so many hashes. Like, why is there so much hash in the 70s? Well,
yeah, that's the thing I was going to say. It's like, how many ways can I do this? I can.
Yeah. There's so many recipes in here that I could. Oh, there's like an entire chapter on beets all by themselves.
Beets?
Beets. B-E-E-T. Beet.
Dirt fruit.
Dirt fruit. Bermuda salad bowl.
What does that mean?
Where's Bermuda? I don't know. Where's Bermuda? Tell me.
It's in the salad bowl.
It is. Right now. One head of cauliflower.
That's, we're already. No, that's fart fruit.
Large Bermuda onion.
Hmm.
Sliced stuffed pimento olives.
Hmm.
French salad dressing.
Ew, 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 ew.
Head of iceberg lettuce, blue cheese crumbles. Toss all ingredients in a bowl.
Okay.
What?
This is not called Bermuda salad bowl. This is called pantry roulette, and I play this when I'm poor. That's what this is. I have one for you. This is from Betty Crocker's Dinner in a Dish cookbook from 1965.
Oh, God.
And this is from a BuzzFeed recipe called 21 Truly Upsetting Vintage Recipes by Ariana Rebellini.
Great.
So number one on this list is tuna and jello pie.
Huh.
Shall I continue?
Do you have to?
Let's take a look-see here. We have one package of lemon flavored gelatin, tomato sauce, vinegar.
Oh, my God.
Salt, Worcestershire sauce, and Tabasco. A dash of pepper. Aha, pimento stuffed olives. They're shoving those fucking pimento stuffed olives.
Why were they obsessed with this?
Chopped onion, a cheese pie shell, and
what
tuna.
What is a cheese pie shell?
There's a recipe below for that.
Okay, great.
So let's make the cheese pie shell, shall we?
Shall we?
Gold medal flour. The brand is important, I suppose. Shortening or lard, your choice. Salt, shredded sharp cheese, and a little bit of water. And then, of course, you need to make the tuna salad and put it in the pie.
It's in a pie.
So dissolve the gelatin in boiling water. Stir in the tomato sauce, vinegar, and seasoning. Chill until slightly thickened. Fold in the celery, olives, and onions.
Fold in the cheese.
Yeah.
What does that mean? I can't teach you everything.
Wow. And you spoon the tuna salad on top of the pie.
Can we make this for our family and make them eat it?
How much rope do we have?
Okay. Oh, because I have found another recipe from the all-time favorite recipe cookbook. This chapter is called Molded Vegetable Salads.
That has to refer to a shape, correct?
It is. Okay. 1 cup cottage ring.
Cottage ring?
3 ounces of lime flavored gelatin.
Mm.
1 cup of mayonnaise.
I mean, I love mayonnaise, but not this. Not like this.
8 ounces of cottage cheese. 1 cup of celery. 1 cup of green peppers. Dissolve. Chill until partially set. Fold in the cottage cheese. Oh, my God. What were they doing?
I'm telling you, everyone was high as fuck.
This is the creamy vegetable. Look at this one. Look at this. Look at it.
I refuse to believe that is food. That looks like a doorstop that someone left outside.
It looks like a poop. I can't even believe this. I can't even believe that this is real. Oh, my God.
Okay. Let's talk about perfection salad from McCall's Great American Recipe Card Collection. 2 envelopes unflavored gelatin. They made it even worse already.
Already? Why do you not have a flavor? By the time you're done, we're going to name the flavor of gelatin that should have been in place of that. Right.
Okay, so we have the 2 envelopes unflavored gelatin, 1/2 cup of sugar, God help us all, 1 teaspoon of salt, 1 can of apple juice, 1/2 cup of lemon juice. We've got vinegar. Why? Shredded carrot, celery, cabbage, green peppers, and you guessed it, pimentos.
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 I'm going to go with orange. Orange-flavored gelatin.
I'm going to go with ass. Ass-flavored gelatin. That's what this is. Should I do another one?
What I'd like to talk about is if you were going to make a gelatin salad, you have to make it. You have to pick. I already have mine. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay. You start out with beef broth and unflavored gelatin. So you're basically making beef gelatin.
Mm-hmm.
You caramelize a shitload of onions. Mm. You also cook mushrooms with butter and garlic. You mix all of that together and you let it set and chill. And you serve with fresh French bread crostini. And it's like French onion soup gelatin.
Huh. Here's the thing.
It's top chef. What are you doing? Make me a jello mold.
All right.
It's bottom chef.
It's bottom chef. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to get a blender and I'm going to get some hot dogs.
What?
And I'm going to blend those hot dogs and then suspend them in hot dog water gelatin.
My God. Wait, then cheese stuffed hot dogs or plain hot dogs?
We're talking Oscar Mayer here. We're talking okay. Oscar Mayer. And then, of course, it would be topped with a nice squirt of ketchup. But here's the thing. No.
That's what it says in this book. It actually says C-A-T-S-U-K.
I can't tell you how much I hate that.
It's what it says. I can show it to you.
I believe you, and I hate it. So here's the thing, though. With things in Jell-O, I've had enough of them, like the fruit ones.
Pear.
Yeah. Sure. And I can't have... Jell-O is so unique of a texture that no other textures can be present, or I'm going to have a bad time. So if I'm going to suspend anything in Jell-O, it's going to be pureed to shit.
Okay.
And so then it can be a terrible flavor experience and not also a terrible texture experience.
Okay.
I'm trying
so
to make this
hot dog flavored gelatin mixed with pureed hot dog topped with ketchup.
No, not ketchup, mayonnaise.
And you feel like that's going to be my French onion, garlic, mushroom, baguette, gelatin, beef. It's like beef. Like it's like pate. Like I've made jello pate is what I just made.
I never said it would win, but it's what I've got. That's what I can offer you, judges. Okay, so we're coming up on the end of the time here, but I want to do something real quick with you. So since as of the recording of this is an ad-free podcast because I don't have enough downloads. Hint, hint, download some stuff. So I'm going to have you make up a pretend ad. So do a little ad spot. You read ads on your podcast, which I'm going to plug for you as well.
Thank you.
I would like you to make up this product. It's called Glorpin Tea. It's all one word, by the way. Okay. So you decide what it is. And do a little tiny baby ad for it.
Okay.
Whenever you're ready, you've got 30 seconds.
Are you tired when you wake up in the morning? Do you feel run down after a long night out with your strudel club? Having a difficult time getting the oompa into your tuba band? Try Glorpin Tea, the caffeinated way to start your day. It's tea and it's a energy drink all in one. Glorpin Tea. Get it where you get energy drinks today. Guten Tag.
Terrific. Terrific. I love it. Well, what a great opportunity for us to plug your podcast. What's your position? Why don't you tell us about it?
What's Your Position is a podcast where we talk about everything that revolve around relationships and sexual health and wellness and positive sexuality and the rights of humans and being in relationships with people, friends, family. We talk about everything. everything from menopause to masturbation. Like we cover the gamut. So we've got 5 seasons. We're in the middle of season 5 right now. We've got some really great episodes about ethical porn, the courtship gap between men and women. We've got one on oral sex. We've got one on anxiety and sex. I love this podcast so very much. And I'm a professor of human sexuality, so you should just listen to what I have to say, basically.
Well, thank you for coming on, and I would love to have you on again. I will see you at Thanksgiving.
I'll see you there. Not if I see you first.
Bring your own aspic.
Bring your own horse foot gelatin.
That's right. All right.
Love, Tater.
All right. Love you, Tater. Bye.
Bye.
There you have it. There's this week's episode. I really hope you enjoyed it. And please go listen to Ashley Weller's podcast, What's Your Position? You can find it where all podcasts are streamed. As always, you can find us on Facebook and Instagram and send in your stories, literally about anything. And I will read them on an episode where it makes sense to read them. Thank you. We'll see you next week. Thank you so much for listening to Tales from the Troll Hole. I'm your host, Cecil B., and this show is produced by me. Our theme song is by Vervex. They're a great band. You should give them a listen. You can stream them anywhere. They're also on TikTok and Instagram. Remember to subscribe so that you don't miss out on a single episode. And also find us on Instagram, and then you can send in your own stories. I just ask that they're true and that they're not going to scar somebody for life. You know what I mean? Anyway, thanks for listening, and I'll see you next week.